way, the citizenship approach. And we've got, I think, a good group of speakers to present that. Now, I'm going to ask a few things. First of all, please turn your cell phones off or turn them on vibrate or something so that we don't hear cell phone noises going off. Point number one. Point number two, we're going to try to keep this running on track because we've got a pretty full day. And so we're going to ask, the speakers were given the option, they're given a time period, and they're given an option as to whether or not they wanted to use some part of that time for questions. If the individual speaker or speakers don't want to do that, then that's what they choose to do. But you'll have a chance at the end of the day, the 5 to 6 o'clock hour, will be a time when people will all be up here, and you'll be able, as a matter of fact, we have to figure out how we're going to all be up here. But we will. It's Rutgers. We will meet the challenge, and we will succeed. And so we will have everybody up here, and you'll be able to ask questions. Also, I ask that, you know, there's a lot of you here. There are more people coming in. Please, you know, if you see a speaker, you know, going to the restroom, you know, let them go. And, you know, don't follow them in and ask questions. Just, you know, you'll have your chance later on. I promise you'll have your chance later on. And so I think that's about it. Oh, one thing I wanted to say about parking. When you came into deck one, you should have gotten a little pink slip. If you didn't, and you got either no slip or some other colored slip, it is Newark. You will probably never see your car again. But if you got, you should have gotten a pink slip, okay? You should have gotten a pink slip. When you also, when you registered, if you told them you were parking, they gave you a little yellow slip. When you go to get your car tonight, you put the pink slip in and it tells you how much, and then you put the yellow slip in and it gives you the lesser amount. You pay the lesser amount and then it gives you your pink slip back, which is what you use to get out of the garage. Trust me on this, I have been through this many times. If you do not have the pink slip, they will not let you out of there. You can talk to them all you want about false imprisonment, about what you're doing. It doesn't matter. You're stuck. You're there. You may, and it's Friday night. No one will be aware. You could die there over the weekend. Nobody will know about your demise until at least Monday morning. So please follow these instructions. All right. Our first speaker, you know, I'm not going to discuss the various approaches because I believe Professor Steiner is going to sort of present the context for us. Gary Steiner, is not only a terrific scholar, but a very, very close friend, and my co-editor on the series on animal ethics that we do for Columbia University Press. Gary is the John Howard Harris Professor of Philosophy at Bucknell University, the author of some really terrific books on animal ethics. Anthropocentrism, I think, is one of the most valuable reference books on Western thinking about animals that exists. As a matter of fact, I think it is the best source book on a history and explanation, and a very accessible explanation of animal ethics. Animals in the Moral Community, Animals in the Limits of Postmodernism, his criticism of postmodernism, which has gotten him many friends given the popularity of postmodernism in modern academia. We have actually, we have security people in the audience who are plainclothes to keep postmodernism from killing them. We're gonna have Gary come up. Gary, you have, and I'm just gonna remind everybody of the time, you have from 10:15 to 11 a.m., at which time you will be tasered. Okay, thank you. Have a good time, everybody. Enjoy.
Thank you, Gary. It's a pleasure to be here. Happy to be part of a very distinguished panel of speakers, and would like to extend my sincere thanks to Gary and Anna for their hospitality and, of course, for everything that they have done on behalf of animals. It's increasingly common to hear people say today that many of the things we do to non-human animals are unjust. Not just wrong, but unjust. To my mind, this suggests that people are becoming more willing to go beyond the point of saying that there are certain things we shouldn't do to animals and make what appears to me to be an even stronger claim, that by doing certain sorts of things to animals, by using them in certain ways, we are infringing upon the rights that animals possess not to be used as instrumentalities for the satisfaction of human needs and desires. To say that something is unjust suggests that the being toward whom it is unjust has natural rights or entitlements, that the being is owed something or is due something, simply in virtue of being the kind of being that it is. This is what Socrates is after when in the Republic he flatly rejects Thrasymachus' ideal of justice as whatever is to the advantage of the stronger, and instead conceives of justice as giving each what is owed to him. Socrates goes on to characterize justice as a certain kind of relationship, one between beings who are tied together by friendship and a sense of common purpose. Socrates, for his own part, does not envision community between human beings and non-human animals, but there's nothing stopping us from denuding his ideal of justice from its anthropocentric prejudice and seeking to affirm a living sense of common purpose between ourselves and non-human animals. And it seems obvious to me that anyone who considers the things we do to animals today to be an injustice is affirming, at least implicitly, a sense of community with non-human animals. But what are we really, really willing to do on behalf of animals? How far does our sense of justice extend? What concretely does justice toward animals require of human beings? And can animals themselves do anything to secure justice for themselves? Or are they unavoidably dependent on the good graces of human beings for the provision of justice? In the course of today's conference, all of these questions will be addressed and debated, and you'll see several themes come to the fore. One is the debate between abolitionism and welfareism, which revolves around the question whether justice for non-human animals requires that we treat animals more humanely while we raise them for food, use them as experimental subjects and sources of entertainment and the like, or whether what we owe to animals must be understood to entail an obligation not to use them as sources of food, knowledge, entertainment, and labor in the first place. A related theme is the controversy over domestication. Is the domestication of animals in its very essence an act of violence, or are there ways of justifying domestication as not only morally permissible, but in fact in the positive interests of non-human animals? A theme that cuts across the abolitionism-welfareism debate and the question of domestication is the controversy over animals as legal property. Are we morally justified in perpetuating a regime of animal ownership? Is being held as property harmful to animals, or does it instead inure to the clear benefit of animals? And a theme that has ramifications for all these other themes is the question of diet. What does a robust sense of justice for non-human animals demand of us from a gustatory standpoint? Does it require us to do essentially nothing? Does it require us to obtain free-range animal products? Does it demand even more of us and require that we become ethical vegetarians or perhaps, dare I say it, even vegans? And if justice requires veganism of us, if veganism, as I do believe, is not simply just another lifestyle choice, but is in fact a strict ethical obligation, what exactly does it mean to be a vegan? And what about all the people I keep hearing about who, for one reason or another, supposedly can't be vegan? How can someone like me characterize veganism as a strict ethical obligation for someone for whom it is impossible to discharge the obligation? Am I not violating Kant's simple edict that ought implies can? What I'd like to do this morning is focus my attention on the third set of questions, those revolving around the ethics of diet. And I'm going to do so by contrasting two different approaches, the liberal and the postmodern. But before I do that, I'd like to say a few things about my views on the first two sets of issues, the abolitionism-welfareism debate and the domestication controversy. Anyone who's read any of my work, or even just my New York Times op-ed piece, Animal, Vegetable, Miserable, published in the New York Times the Sunday before Thanksgiving in 2009, is aware that I'm an unremitting abolitionist. I believe, as Gary Francione and a number of the other speakers today believe, that animals possess an inherent moral worth that ought never to be compromised by using animals as instrumentalities for the satisfaction of human needs and desires. Some philosophers, indeed the dominant voices in the Western philosophical tradition, have seen no problem with using animals as instrumentalities because these thinkers view animals from the ground up as nothing more than resources that we human beings are cosmically entitled to consume. As odd as it might sound to us enlightened moderns and postmoderns, Aristotle, the Stoic philosophers of antiquity, and medieval Christian thinkers from Augustine and St. Thomas and beyond argued that animals were made explicitly by the gods or by God as resources to satisfy human needs. Thus, none of these thinkers believe that we have any duties of justice toward animals because we share no bond of community with them. But while it would appear that the decentering and anonymizing tendencies of modern science have dispossessed us of the idea that anything in nature was created for any specific purpose, let alone for the satisfaction of human needs, a great many people today adhere to the old formula according to which animals are ultimately nothing more than raw material for the satisfaction of our desires. I hope I'm not the only person in the room who is troubled, although not surprised, by the self-serving inconsistency of abandoning as myth the idea that earthly things were created for our use, while retaining the equally mythic idea that animals are nothing more than objects to be used. But, you will protest, as thinkers from Peter Singer to Jacques Derrida have done, Jeremy Bentham changed everything by observing that the proper criterion for moral status is not whether a being can talk or reason, but rather whether it can suffer. I've lost count of how many times I've had that cheerful observation thrown in my face when I'm carping at people about animal rights. What I haven't lost count of is the precious few times I've encountered people who know what else Bentham says in that famous footnote from his Introduction to the Principles and Morals of Legislation, namely, that we are perfectly entitled to kill and eat animals inasmuch as, quote, they have none of those long protracted anticipations of future misery which we have, and inasmuch as the death that they suffer in our hands commonly is and always may be a speedier, and by that means a less painful one, than that which would await them in the inevitable course of nature, end quote. Simply put, on Bentham's view, we should care about animals because they can suffer, but we need not care too much about them. And in fact, we can go along doing pretty much anything we were doing to them before, provided that we do it humanely. All this from a thinker whose intent in that famous footnote is to ridicule Kant for having degraded animals into the class of things. If elevating animals from things to persons, as Bentham clearly implies he is doing, means that we can continue to kill and eat them, then I would submit that we are dealing with an extremely perverse conception of personhood. What then about domestication? Is that regime consistent with an active recognition of the personhood of non-human animals? I have a feeling that this is going to be one of the most hotly contested questions today, so I'll simply say a few things to get you thinking about what is at stake in this controversy. When we consider the notion of personhood pre-reflectively, we often tend to think exclusively of human beings and perhaps even more narrowly of cognitively mature humans. A deeper reflection on the essence of personhood takes us to the notion of agency, literally the capacity to act. In De Veritate, St. Thomas Aquinas states that animals, he says, non agunt sed magis agentur, which means that they do not act but rather are acted upon. Descartes became a kind of standard bearer for this view of animals when he went even further and argued that animals are simply biological machines with no inner awareness whatsoever. Bentham went a step in the direction of attributing agency to animals when he observed that animals can suffer, although he did too little to reflect on and acknowledge the fact that beings that can suffer are also beings who can fare well or ill in life, and who can undertake courses of action on their own behalf rather than needing others to act for them. An agent in this sense is a being who may sometimes need others to act on his or her behalf, but who on other occasions, and who typically is able to act for him or herself. At bottom, the question whether domestication is compatible with justice for animals, with giving animals what we owe them, is not simply the question whether animals benefit from domestication, but whether domestication promotes or instead abrogates the agency of animals. Some of us speaking today are at best dubious and at worst completely hostile to the proposition that domestication, done properly, can promote the agency of non-human animals. Others speaking today appear to me to follow at least loosely the reasoning offered by Lucretius in De Rerum Natura when he states that domesticated animals willingly and deliberately accepted some subjection to human beings in exchange for the protection from wild predation that we provide to them. Many who oppose domestication on principle argue that we ought to end domestication altogether, that we ought to steward the existing domesticated animals, let the lines die out, and look forward to a future without the existence of domesticated animals, inasmuch as domestication is inherently slavery. Those who favor the continuation of domestication tend to believe that even if the current conditions of domestication are morally problematic, there are ways to alter those conditions so that domestication benefits animals and perhaps even serves as an institutional mechanism for the affirmation and cultivation of animal agency. These, at least in broad strokes, are the terms of the debate over domestication. And for the time being, I'll leave you in suspense about my own views on the question, and I'm going to turn my attention back to the question of justice, the ethics of diet, and a raging debate in contemporary scholarship between liberal and postmodern thinkers about how best to conceive of the idea of justice and our moral connectedness to non-human animals. A year ago, my book, Animals and the Limits of Postmodernism, was released. In that book, I argue for veganism as a strict ethical obligation on the part of human beings, and I ground what I call the vegan imperative in the notion of cosmic holism that I developed in the previous book, Animals and the Moral Community. Cosmic holism is a challenge to liberal individualism, with its assumption of the fundamental superiority of human beings over everything else in the world, and its concomitant assumption that human beings are superior precisely because they alone possess something like Kantian autonomy. Cosmic holism takes its bearings from ancient thinkers such as the Stoics and modern thinkers such as Schopenhauer, who see reality as a totality, as a whole, in which human beings play a subordinate role. But my conception of cosmic holism involves a revision of the Stoic Schopenhauerian view of the world so as to divest it of its anthropocentric prejudice. Rather than seeing human beings as part of a larger cosmic whole, but nonetheless ultimately superior to non-human beings such as animals, I argue that we ought to see ourselves as part of a cosmic whole in which we human beings are alone in being autonomous in the Kantian sense, but in which this unique claim on autonomy in no way entails that we are morally superior to any other sentient creatures. It's in virtue of our capacity for detached reflection and predicatively structured language that we human beings are capable of taking on moral obligations that no non-human animals appear to be capable of assuming. This capacity makes it possible for human beings to recognize our interconnectedness with all sentient life and a corresponding sense of cosmic justice. Traditional anthropocentric thinkers, from Epicurus and Aristotle to John Rawls, have conceived of justice in strictly social terms, as a set of relationships exclusively between human agents, such that animals are categorically excluded from the sphere of justice, and nothing we do to an animal can be construed as an injustice. For anyone whose sensibilities resemble those that I described at the beginning of my talk, such a conception of justice falls clearly short of a sense of owing something to non-human animals. The idea of cosmic holism grounds a broader conception of cosmic, as opposed to merely social justice, a notion of cosmic justice that embraces the idea that it's entirely possible to inflict injustices on non-human sentient beings. At the same time, I consider it important to retain certain traditional concepts and categories, particularly the classical liberal notions of principles, autonomy, and rights. And I believe that we need to understand what we owe to animals in terms of liberal notions such as right and obligation, grounded in an underlying sense of cosmic holism and cosmic justice. And this is where I recognize the need to write Animals and the Limits of Postmodernism. Some of you are aware that there's been a great profusion of writing about animals and their moral status in recent years, some of it from a liberal perspective, and a rapidly increasing proportion of it from a variety of postmodern perspectives. What I find troubling about the various postmodern approaches to animals that are currently exercising a great deal of influence is their collective emphasis on what Derrida called the undecidability of meaning, a fundamental ambiguity or indeterminacy owing to the irreducible multiplicity of worldly phenomena. Where traditional thinkers such as the classical liberals saw the possibility of using abstract conceptualization to arrive at general conclusions and principles bearing upon the nature of reality and moral obligation, postmodern thinkers oppose such generalities on two interrelated grounds. They dismiss principles on epistemological grounds, arguing that any attempt to reduce the rich multiplicity of meaning to general categories does violence to the particular by subsuming it forcefully under universal rubrics. And postmodern thinkers dismiss principles on political grounds, arguing that as a pragmatic matter, principles function as nothing more and nothing less than tools for the suppression of difference and the disempowerment of marginalized others. Now, while principles can and certainly have been used as tools of oppression, I do not believe that this is an unavoidable consequence of the very appeal to principles. Nor do I believe that postmodern thinkers are consistent in their repudiation of principles. Any postmodern thinker who proclaims that human violence against animals is an injustice is appealing, if only implicitly and against his or her own intention, to an underlying sense of the place of human beings in the cosmic scheme of things, and to a corresponding sense of what we owe to animals, a sense that can, at least in general terms, be characterized in terms of a moral principle, namely, that peace is to be preferred to violence, and that easily avoidable violence against a sentient being is the worst kind of injustice. It's noteworthy that Derrida, that most influential of postmodern thinkers in current discussions of animals, criticizes the appeal to general principles only to come full circle to a clear pronouncement of the evil that we perpetrate in our customary uses of animals. This is not to say that Derrida did not genuinely care about animals, but rather that judgments about evil and violence presuppose access to exactly the conception of abstract principles that postmodern thinkers roundly reject on epistemological and political grounds. If the proponents of postmodern thought make no place for classical liberal notions of right and responsibility, then they are faced with a serious dilemma, that between quietism and decisionism. In the absence of principles that can function as what Kant called regulative ideals for our conduct, we're thrown back on our naked confrontation with an irreducible multiplicity of particular phenomena, each of which is singular in the sense that it is absolutely unique and ultimately incomparable with any other unique particular. Thus, anyone who would abandon the rational appeal to principles is left either to stare passively at the infinite parade of irreducible singularities, or to assert an ethical decision on the basis of essentially nothing. I say nothing because the very notion of singularity or irreducible multiplicity that lies at the core of the postmodern conception of our confrontation with reality is fundamentally at odds with any attempt to isolate or abstract common ethically significant features in virtue of which one could characterize singular events as having ethical significance. It's with a sensitivity to the irreducible uniqueness of worldly phenomena, to the problem of what Derrida variously characterized as the supplement, the trace, or difference, that Carrie Wolfe has argued that any attempt to ground ethical decision in general principles, quote, reduces ethics to the very antithesis of ethics by reducing the aporia of judgment in which the possibility of justice resides to the mechanical unfolding of a positivist calculation, end quote. In other words, conceiving of ethics in terms of general principles simply reduces the urgency of ethical decision to mindless lever pulling. And there's something right in this idea. To adhere to principles blindly, without remaining constantly vigilant as to when and how they're to be applied, is to behave like the person Kant describes in What is Enlightenment, who would like to subscribe once and for all to a specific set of doctrines, thereby closing off permanently any further rational reflection or debate on whether those doctrines were or remain legitimate. But Wolfe is doing something more than Kant, and something with perilous implications for ethics. Unlike Kant, who accepts the ideal of principles but sees the need always to be questioning and reflecting on their nature and proper application, Wolfe, Derrida, and thinkers like them reject out of hand the very idea of principles, and indeed for the epistemological and political reasons I have already outlined. Put another way, Where Kant undertakes a merely immanent critique of reason, according to which reason can and must function to reflect on its own nature and limits, postmodern thinkers such as Wolff and Derrida undertake a comparatively total critique of reason that at best reduces reason to just another instinct or behavioral tendency, and at worst dismisses reason altogether from the moral life. Postmodern thinkers take their bearings from Nietzsche, who articulated a pointedly polemical conception of discourse. On Nietzsche's view, discourse never attains a detached and objective vantage point on reality, and particularly not one on value. Instead, all discourse is polemical in the literal sense that it is warfare all the way down, which is to say that it can never be anything more than the expression of a perspective that seeks to exercise dominance over all other perspectives. A corollary of Nietzsche's perspectivism is the proposition that what the philosophical tradition has called reason is really the expression of an attempt to exercise dominance that is cloaked in the guise of impartiality, when in fact there is no such thing as impartiality, but again, only perspectives of power. Thus, it's perfectly understandable that Nietzsche would deride traditional ethical and political ideals such as equality, mutual respect, and peaceful community, and in their place would glorify violence. That postmodern thinkers find inspiration in Nietzsche's perspectivism is puzzling given its pernicious implications for the notion of justice. From his perspectivism, Nietzsche proceeds to a notion of justice that is of a piece with Thrasymachus's cheerful proclamation that justice is whatever to the is to the advantage of the stronger. From Nietzsche, genuine freedom is not what Kant said it is, namely voluntary subjection to a law of mutual respect that one has legislated for oneself. Instead, for Nietzsche, freedom in its purest form is, quote, and I'm not making this up, the affective superiority in relation to him who must obey, end quote. Justice, by the same token, is nothing like granting another what is his or her due, but instead, for Nietzsche, consists in arrogating to oneself whatever one considers necessary in the pursuit of an ideal that one has posited for oneself, and that itself has the same sort of singular character as the movable host of metaphors that postmodern thinkers believe we encounter and experience. But there is this crucial difference. Where Nietzsche derides as life-denying any conception of justice that call for a sense of owing something to others, instead basing his cosmopolitical vision on the doctrine of the will to power, postmodern thinkers seek to divorce the metaphysical and epistemological underpinnings of Nietzsche's perspectivism from their pointedly pernicious ethico-political implications. There simply is no giving primacy to irreducible difference without at the same time sacrificing the prospect of establishing general principles on the basis of which we can make judgments about different supposedly singular events and how we ought to evaluate and respond to them. Thus, the dilemma between quietism and decisionism, a dilemma with which postmodern thinkers have yet to come to grips. That postmodern thinkers repeatedly proclaim concern for a variety of oppressed others, some of them human and some of them non-human, confirms that these thinkers are unwilling to settle for quietistic staring at the parade of singular phenomena with which we find ourselves confronted in experience. But just how close to affirming clear and determinate obligations to oppressed others, such as animals, do postmodern thinkers ultimately come? In this connection, I'm reminded of a statement that Derrida once made at an academic conference to the effect that he was, quote, a vegetarian in his soul, end quote. This ambiguous statement is best read against the background of another statement that Derrida once made, that he was not, quote, recalling the violence perpetrated against animals by human beings in order to start a support group for vegetarianism, ecologism, or for the societies for the protection of animals, end quote. And why not? Recall Kerry Wolfe's verdict regarding ethical principles. On the postmodern view espoused by a Wolfe or a Derrida, any definitive claim about the moral status of animals, or about anything else for that matter, would neutralize the urgency of questioning, the so-called aporia that must remain alive at the center of all ethical judgment. Thus, any categorical call for vegetarianism, veganism, the abolition of the property status of animals, or any other determinate measure intended to secure justice for animals, would, on the postmodern account, actually destroy the prospect of justice. But let's dig just a little deeper here. If the proclamation of a determinate ethical principle, such as the vegan imperative, would foreclose the possibility of justice, is this to say that refraining from making such categorical judgments leaves open the prospect of genuine justice for animals? In fact, I think it does not. For basic to the approach of thinkers such as Derrida is the a priori presupposition that justice by its very nature is an elusive notion, that it, like all phenomena or aspirational goals, cannot ultimately be secured because it is subject to the irreducible play of différence. Derrida and postmodern thinkers who follow him argue that the belief that justice can be comprehended and progressively worked toward is simply a delusion produced by what postmodern thinkers love to call the metaphysics of presence. All of this is a result of the total critique of reason undertaken, if only unwittingly, by postmodern thinkers. And the question whether their verdict about the nature of and prospects for justice is legitimate ultimately comes down to the question whether we ought to be persuaded by the terms of a total critique of reason. I, for one, am not. The very idea of justice is founded on notions of right, responsibility, and agency that the postmodern approach utterly destroys through the primacy it places on singularity and the undecidability of meaning. Thus, when a thinker such as Derrida decries apartheid or the violence we inflict on non-human animals, both of which he did, he's appealing, if only implicitly and against his own intention, to a regulative notion of right that by its very nature transcends the individual supposedly singular moments or events to which it is applied, to which it is applied in calls for justice or charges of injustice. But at the same time, I recognize that reason by itself is insufficient to ground ethical commitments and move people to make concrete changes in their values and their behavior. I've lost count of how many times people have told me that they find my arguments for ethical veganism to be completely compelling, but that they just find the taste of meat so good, or that it's just part of their culture to eat meat, or that their friends just wouldn't understand if they went vegan. This is what led me to conclude animals in the limits of postmodernism with the suggestion that what is ultimately needed to bring about a soul conversion in people regarding veganism, or for that matter about any urgent ethical problem in connection with which our culture has entrenched values and practices that we ought to recognize to be unjust, is a shocking, dislocating experience that catapults us out of our accustomed ways of valuing and acting and makes us see the world in an entirely different way. So Sue Kozer does this for me. One of my first experiences of this kind was reading Upton Sinclair's The Jungle when I was 15 years old. The sense of horror that filled me when I read that book has never left me, and I've never seen the world in the same way since reading it. Poor Mrs. Barberini, my 10th grade American lit teacher, thought I completely missed the point of the book when I wrote my term paper on the egregious treatment of animals in the food industry. It's in 1971. Since she took it as an established and incontrovertible fact that the book is entirely about the egregious treatment of human beings. Of course, this was over 40 years ago, so perhaps Mrs. Barberini could be forgiven for lacking the refined sensibilities that we possess today about animal oppression and its entanglements with human oppression. Or perhaps nothing at all has changed in 40 years, in spite of a vast profusion of writing and hand-wringing about the moral status of animals during the intervening time. And that is my worry, that essentially nothing has changed, that the regime of human injustice against animals persists virtually unmodified. After all, how many strict ethical vegans do you know? Thank you. Do we have Gary?
You've got 12 minutes.
Anything?
Gary?
Oh, sorry.
Whoever's first. Sorry.
So I found it very interesting. I found your conclusion a little bit jarring, given what you had said about postmodernists, right? Because the conclusion is that reason doesn't compel action.
Not by itself.
Well, I understand. And so this suggests to me that the postmodernists, I think your critique of postmodernism as a normative framework is very effective, but perhaps they're onto something psychologically, right? And so the idea would be that that one needs more than a set of persuasive, rational arguments to persuade people to change their behavior. You point to one, which is a shocking, dislocating experience, right? When somebody sees earthlings or something, and they change. But there are others, and so I wonder if you had any thoughts about that. So let me just sort of, say that to my mind, one of the most powerful is social connection. All right, so I went vegan 7 or 8 years ago at the same time as Sherry did. The reason we went vegan undoubtedly was we've been exposed to Gary for all of those years. And then a bunch of our friends started to do this, and we found community. And, I'd like to think it's because of the power of the ideas, but I also think it's no accident that these things spread almost like the way, in a non-pejorative sense, the way a social contagion does. Right? So I'm a little bit perplexed by your sort of the negativity of your conclusion when, I think the vegan movement is growing, and that may be a kind of, it's partly due to reason, but partly due to these other factors.
Yeah, I had urged Gary to let me have the whole day. I don't have a little more to say. I will say this. I think you're right. I ended this on a down note for reasons I'm not going to go into now. It has to do with what's going on in my life right now. What I'm working on is, in the current book work, is the kind of mutual influence of reason and affect or emotion in the moral life. And I'm working on Adam Smith, and I'm working on Jesse Prince's work, and there's some people doing some interesting work about how reason and affect have to influence each other. Laura Kaminsky, who's here, calls it rational empathy. That's the expression we use for it, right? And it's an interesting idea. I don't know if Laura and I are exactly doing this the same way, but I think there's a lot of affinities here. I think that when that kind of contagion occurs, and I think to the extent that it occurs, it's great. It is kind of descriptively correct, I think, or accurate to say that that's the way it happens. But I think when that occurs, what's going on, if it works the way I would like to see it work, is there's different ways a person who hangs out with Gary Francione could become a vegan. Everybody has a crush on Gary, and that could be a reason to, become a vegan. That would not be the right reason to become a vegan. The right reason to become a vegan is because you certainly start to occupy that standpoint that he occupies, and you sort of feel the world the way he feels it, which is this revulsion at what we've done and what we continue to do. That's something that happens at the level of the affects. And what I think, this idea of rational empathy as opposed to just emotional contagion, the way Franz de Waal talks about it, is the idea of having emotions, some of which we shouldn't accede to, and others that withstand the test of rational scrutiny and can actually mature through rational reflection. So if I'd had another period of time to talk, I would have said more about what I'm trying to do with the affects. And in some ways, it does have affinities with the postmodern approach, but ultimately I think I'm trying to come up with more concrete grounds for moral obligation by bringing affect into the framework, but I'm really resistant to this idea of everything being a parade of this movable host of metaphors, ideas, and niches. But thanks for the push. Yeah, please.
My question centers on the same part, the conclusion, but agreeing. So during all my advocacy, the logic stands up. People do agree with the argument, and many times you are at a point where they're just like, I agree with this, but I can't go vegan right now. Or we have conversations around this, but a lot of it is like having them want to accede to what their logic tells them, like maybe they just need time to wrestle with the cognitive dissonance and so forth. But there's something to be said for shocking people, dislocating them and so forth. And so that's something that through my activities I've played with, not having footage of animals, stuff, like animal exploitation of various kinds, and with it, and maybe just showing food. And it's one of the ways of sort of getting people to think about this in a way that doesn't just come purely through the logical tubes. Because I think when you get them both together, somebody sees the arguments and they have no emotional reason to deny what they need to do, so they're compelled to do it. So I guess the question I'm getting down to is, you know, there's philosophical, presumably, arguments for why one should or shouldn't use certain kinds of imagery in order to dislocate someone. You know, like a, like, you know, violent footage of animals being slaughtered, for example, versus maybe just sort of more standard industry confinement practices, which are also violent. You know, so where do we, you know, in the course of trying to dislocate people, where do we look to for guidelines for how to do that in ways that are not just compelling but also, you know, ethical?
Yeah, I mean, that's a million-dollar question, and I can only say a little about it because I do not have a definitive answer to this. The first thing that comes to mind is the sense that it's not going to be the same for different people. It was different for me and Mrs. Barberini, right? It just was, and I think a lot of people who read The Jungle don't come away with that sense of, holy shit, what is going on here? There's this image early in the book of this pig just being kind of torn apart live and not a drop hits the ground. That affects different people in different ways. My guess is that slaughterhouse videos actually affect different people in different ways. I can't watch them anymore. And I've never been able to actually, kind of out myself in this, I've never been able to actually get myself to go to a place like that. I just can't. But I think there is something a little elusive about it. I don't think this is the kind of thing that even if you transfer some of the weight of what's going on from reason to affect, I don't think that means that there's a button you can push or that you could reduce this to like a recursive procedure that a computer can carry out where we can sort of deploy affective stimuli and, you know, everybody in the room would suddenly have a soul conversion. I think it's that old Platonic problem that the nature of a soul conversion is something that remains really elusive. And one way or another, I think what it has to come down to, what it has to produce, is a sense of identification with non-human animals to get to that point of seeing that it's like when, I'll just draw an analogy. When I talk with my students who are, you know, 35 years younger than me, it took me a while to realize it's not like I'm an adult and they're, to me, comparatively children. We're the same. It just so happens that there are these kind of accidents of age and embodiment that happen to put me in a different place on the timeline than them, but it had no essential significance whatsoever. And when I learned that, that was when I learned began to learn how to be a teacher. You know, it was when I realized I'm talking to myself. I'm not talking to somebody 35 years younger than me who's completely different than me. And by the same token, I think the way that soul conversion has to work in my mind and heart is people have to recognize I'm looking at myself. I'm relating to myself. You know, but how you actually do that, I think, you know, that's a place for collaborative work, and I'm very open to, you know, any suggestions, or, you know, I like to watch what other people do and see what works. You know.
A short story by way of anecdotal discussion on this point. I have a coworker. I live in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, which is the hunting capital of America. And I have a coworker who is an avid hunter and who tries to respect my views by, you know, not discussing or hunting excursion and so forth. 2 days ago, we were discussing, there's a local dairy near me, and I've been trying to figure out how to approach this dairy to save some of the calves that would be destroyed and take them to a local farm sanctuary. And one of the employees of that dairy came in to pay bill, and she said, are you going to talk to him about the calves? And I said, no, I think I'm going to write them a letter. And she was asking me more about the calf thing, and I showed her a picture of a two-day-old calf who was dead in a wheelbarrow. And the caption was something about, you know, here I am, my mother will never see me again, but it's okay because you need to eat cheese. And she flew off the handle at me and asked me if she should show me pictures of her slain deer, and that I should respect her and not show her these images. And I said, these images are why I don't hunt and why I don't eat deer. I'm really aware of the reality of what happens to deer. This is the reality of what happens to calves because people eat cheese. And she was visibly upset. The point of all that is that it's not a linear journey. It's not a linear thing that you can say, well, if we just inspire some sort of emotional response in somebody, that they'll go, oh, you know, they'll get the arguments, they'll have the emotional response, and they'll go, oh, yeah, okay, now it's time. You know, there's a lot involved. Her upbringing as a hunter, you know, growing up in rural Pennsylvania, you know, and just the cognitive dissonance of, wait a minute, you know, yes, this upsets me, I don't want to see it, but I'm going to still go eat cheese, you know.
Yeah.
So there's that. You have talked a lot in your work about kinship and how to extend that kinship. And I think that's an important notion because, one of the things that I'm trying to figure out in my work is how empathy fits into that, and it's how to extend the circle of kinship to include non-human animals. And one of the things I'm finding in my work is even the arguments from vegans trying to approach people are taking their own kind of anthropocentric view, and it's good for us. Let's sell it on it's good for humans. You know, it's all about humans. It's all about our community. It's all about our health or the environment. So those are all great things, but how do you bring it back to extending that kinship of community in so much detail?
Yeah, that's the key question. I know I have to wrap up, so I just want to say one thing. One thing that Laura's remarks remind me of is how common it is for people to say, in response to calls, say, for veganism on ethical grounds, look, if you want to be a vegan, that's fine, but don't force your lifestyle choices on me, as if it's a lifestyle choice. The last thing I'll say is this. I mentioned a little while ago that things that are happening in my life affect the way I say things. And there was one time a few years ago when I got in some deep yogurt with friends of mine who were planning a friend reunion, and they started bandying about through these group emails, chit-chat about, you know, barbecuing sides of beef. And I thought, why are they copying me on this stuff? They know exactly, you know, where I stand on all these things. And the first one came, and I said, I'm going to be a bigger person, I'm going to let it go. The second one came, and I almost wrote back a nasty note. I let it go. And the third one came, and I popped my cork, and I wrote back a note and said, look, if you all want to bandy about these ideas, please leave me out of it, because you all know for a fact we're dealing with a person who thinks that meat eating is the moral equivalent of child rape. Not my best moment, but then I started getting pushback from one of my friends in particular who was grievously offended by this, and I said, look, here's the problem I'm in, here's the bind I'm in. I believe what I said to be true, so I can't take it back. I guess if I were able to go back and turn the clock back, I might have chosen different words or something, but I can't say that what I said was incorrect. Whether that was, and interestingly, in that particular case, it actually led to a length. He's a high energy particle physicist. He actually read Animals in the Rural Community in its entirety. And now, when he's buying furniture, he's calling me up and saying, look, if I were to buy a sofa bed with leather, would you feel bad about snooping on it? That's at least a start for somebody who previously had no concern about animal issues at all. So I better stop there, huh?
Gary mentioned one of the ways that people get the moral impulse to act on rational ideas. He mentioned there are different ways, and he said for him, the work of Sue Coe really mattered. We have Sue Coe here today. I think she's the most accomplished political artist of my generation. I tried to get her to speak, and she said she wanted to be at a university for once without giving the talk. So she's here today. But I'm glad she's here. Her work is, and actually we have it all over our house. As a matter of fact, people come over for dinner and then oftentimes commit suicide by dessert. It is somewhat, you know, it does sort of hit you. And we've got it's literally all over the house in every room. But it inspires, you know, it's true. I mean, it's true, Gary. I mean, it inspires. People look at it who aren't vegan. And you don't have to say anything. They start trying to engage you about it. It's having a Suco hanging in your house is the easiest way to get discussions going. I agree with you here. Okay, we have Sue Donaldson and Will Kymlicka coming up now. Somebody came up to me before and said, why do you have three couples today? And I said, this is a sort of thing where if one does it, either, you know, you sort of do it together, or things don't work. But, you know, and so it's, yeah, so we have three couples, you know, Michael Dorf and Sherry Colb, Will and Sue and Anna and me. And so Will and Sue have written a book that I think is, as far as I'm concerned, the only really new, I mean, you know, it's, they're trying to do something, they're trying to think outside the boxes that are currently constructed of abolition and welfare, and they're trying to get a different perspective on that debate. And I think it's the only really interesting new thing that's come out recently. And so, it's not to say I agree with it, but I think it's very, very good. So, and I'm delighted that they're here, and Will, Sue, please come down. And Will is the Canada Research Professor at Queen's University. He's been a philosophy professor for a while. He's written a lot of books on citizenship, democracy, multiculturalism. Sue is an independent researcher. The book is terrific. Have fun.
So my PowerPoint is on, oh yes, it's right here.
This is what they've done to us. They've turned us into completely dependent. We don't know what we're doing in the game.
Thank Gary and Anna for organizing this conference, and Will and I are really thrilled to be here and appreciate the invitation. We're dividing our presentation like this. I'm going to begin by situating the idea of animal citizenship in relation to the overall themes of the conference, briefly exploring some of the underlying premises regarding the citizenship approach. And here the key idea is that human and non-human animals inevitably and appropriately form interspecies communities along various dimensions. And these communities can be guided by justice. Following from this, I'll argue that thinking about animals in terms of membership and citizenship does not involve anthropomorphism or conceptual overstretch, and that the worry that it does so rests on mistaken assumptions about natural human-animal divides in relation to our capacities, our psychosocial development, and our lived socio-political history and experience. At that point, I'm going to turn it over to Will, who will explore in finer detail some of the challenges and promise of citizenship theory for animals, focusing specifically on the model of co-citizenship for humans and domesticated animals in an interspecies pose. So where does citizenship fit into the structure of this conference? Animal welfare describes a range of positions which recognize that animals have welfare interests and that humans have duties towards animals, but which grant priority to human interests. Obviously, proponents disagree about the scope and strength of this priority, but share the presumption of human-animal hierarchy. Abolitionists or animal rights views reject this hierarchy, arguing that humans do not have a right to harm or exploit animals for our benefit. Animals have the same right to live their lives as we do ours, and we must therefore end all human ownership of and exploitation of animals. And that would be the position that Will and I are starting from, is that we should abolish human ownership and exploitation of animals. But what happens the day after abolition? And this is where citizenship comes in. Citizenship is one possible answer to the question of how we imagine relations between humans and animals in a post-abolition world. But it's not the only answer. Some believe that humans and animals rightly occupy separate worlds, and the post-abolition world should intend an end to human-animal relations. Domestic animals should be rewild or rendered extinct. Wild animals should be respected from a distance in their own worlds out there. We should stop owning, exploiting, and directly harming animals, but for the most part, we will leave them alone to get on with their separate lives in their own societies. Citizenship starts from very different premises. Firstly, there are not and never have been separate human and animal worlds. We have always been and always will be part of interspecies communities. Human action through domestication, which is wrong on our view, domestication, has altered the nature and terms of this interspecies world, but it has not altered the basic fact of interspecies community. One need only look around at the birds and voles and deer and raccoons and millions of other non-domesticated animals who live in our homes, our yards, and neighborhoods to see this. We inevitably and appropriately have various kinds of relationships with animals, and our conceptions of political community and rights need to reflect this. But why do Will and I propose different statuses for different animals, reflecting their different relationships with us, rather than positing a single, undifferentiated, global interspecies community? Our goal is to be responsive to the different interests, needs, and desires and possibilities for animals as both individuals and members of communities. Animals differ in the extent of their dependency on humans, the possibilities for interaction with us, their desire for interaction with us, and the extent and ways in which they can or cannot benefit from these relationships. And so our theory proposes co-citizenship for domesticated animals who strongly need or desire and can benefit from close cooperation with humans, denizenship status for the countless liminal animals like those raccoons and Canada geese and foxes, who are strongly adapted to human settlement and need rights of residency and accommodation, but would not, for the most part, benefit from the kind of close cooperation that's desirable for some domesticated animals. And as for those truly wild animals who avoid humans and do not adapt well to coexistence with us, we should recognize their rights to sovereignty, to self-determination on their own territories, free from invasion and colonization. This does not mean that we have no positive duties to wild animals, but that our understanding of these duties needs to be grounded in respect for their preferences and their interests in living largely independently of us. I should note that these categories are not rigid assignments, but statuses intended to be responsive to individual interests and agency. One can imagine various scenarios in which individual animals or groups of animals move between these categories as their circumstances change. On our theory, protecting interests within these three general categories of relationship calls for different kinds of positive rights, in addition, of course, to the basic negative rights guaranteed by basic animal rights theory, which respond to different interests. I'm not going to go further into detail about that now because Will's going to pick up that story a little bit later. Instead, I wish to go back to the earlier question of how we imagine the post-abolition world in general terms. Do we imagine it in terms of human-animal separation, each to our own worlds, or in terms of interspecies socio-political communities? And there are several disagreements underlying these separation versus citizenship visions. Questions like, is it ethical to control animals' reproductive lives to bring about their extinction? Do domestic animals and their descendants have a right to benefit from the wealthy societies they have helped to create if they simply expel or extinguish them? Breeding is destiny. Are domesticated animals doomed to a life without dignity because they have been bred to serve human purposes in the past? Is it feasible that we can design adequate legal protections for these most dependent and vulnerable members of society? All of these are important issues that we need to consider carefully, and Will is going to be returning to some of them. But I think that the core disagreement goes deeper. It rests on this idea that animals have their world and we humans have ours. It's about how we fundamentally conceive society or the polis and the associated ideals of community, sociability, cooperation, reciprocity, civility, belonging, and so on. For some animal rights theorists, these ideas are essentially humanist in their origin and only derivatively applicable to animals. That is, society is understood as an exclusively human project defined by and for relations amongst humans, and while we may have artificially and unnaturally and unjustly brought domesticated animals into our society, they don't belong here, and any attempt to apply these ideas to human-animal relations involves an inherently problematic form of extensionism or conceptual overstretch. the idea of Zoopolis challenges this way of rendering animals invisible. Our societies are interspecies to the core, and a fundamental task of animal rights is to articulate how animals are already part of shared communities and concepts. Animals' presence, their characteristics, their actions and relationships, their agency, in short, has shaped our society and political ideas from the ground up. Concepts like freedom, resistance, voice, belonging, cooperation, compassion, and justice emerged in interspecies community to make sense of the diverse relationships within it. As we all know, Western political theory has systematically excluded animals from our governing political ideologies, rendering them invisible. While animals live amongst us and are profoundly implicated and exploited in almost every dimension of socio-political life, they are the ghosts in our machine, in Liz Marshall's phrase. Our interspecies society has been politically theorized and legally codified as an exclusively human project. Human supremacist ideologies have rendered animals and their agency invisible, making them vulnerable to horrendous violence and exploitation. But the remedy for this is not to treat animals as some sort of abnormal aberration from what is or ought to be purely human social project, but rather to combat the arbitrary and illegitimate exclusion of animals from our theories of society and the protections of membership. In this sense, the Zoopolis model is, as reflected in these quotes from Christiane Bailey and Ava Meyer, is not a matter of extending membership to animals. Rather, it is a matter of recognizing animals' membership, recognizing those who are here and who have always been here. Of course, in one sense, any approach to animal rights, abolitionism, citizenship, liberation, can be said to involve extension or expansion. We're all trying to overcome human exclusivist and supremacist ideologies in order to extend or expand ideas of moral status or moral rights or personhood or citizenship to animals. But it's important that in this process we avoid perpetuating human-centric myths of community and citizenship, thereby compounding the problem of animals' invisibility. So in the remainder of my comments, I want to consider two examples of how in the very process of arguing for the extension of rights to animals, we too often implicitly accept human-centric myths while ignoring the existing irreducible diversity of political communities in a way that's harmful to both humans and animals. The first example concerns the notion of expanding circles of concern across degrees of social distance. This is usually offered as a description of affective development, or how we come to include others in our moral or political community or circles of concern. The idea is that our affective attachments start with attachment to the self, then expand outwards, first to our immediate family, then to larger kin or tribal networks, then to national communities, and to humanity as a whole. While many theorists assume that humanity sets the outer bounds, animal rights theorists insist that we can expand even further, in the step which Gary Steiner calls cosmic holism, extending beyond the species boundary to include all sentient life. This idea of affective development is often illustrated something like this. I hope you can read that, but notice the assumptions here. The family is human, the tribe is human, the nation is human, the community of nations is human, and according to Gary Steiner, social justice pertains to relations within the human community. Whereas the outer sphere of cosmic justice expands to include non-human sentient life. So it's only when we extend outside of the human social realm that we come to the interspecies realm and the inclusion of animals. But this is a false picture because we've always lived in interspecies communities and our ideas of family, tribe, and nation have always been interspecies. For most of us, the idea of family doesn't need to be expanded to include animals. We are born into interspecies families and learn our concept of family in that context. Similarly, our concept of community has always included domesticated, liminal, and wild animals along various dimensions. Consider a child growing up in a traditional pastoral family, spending his summers up with the herds in the hills. Who are his family, his kin and tribe, and who are distant strangers? Or a child growing up on a traditional mixed farm, performing her morning and evening chores and activities with the animals. Or more relevantly today in North America, consider the child growing up in a home with a cat or a hamster companion, with neighborhood dogs, with the local park squirrels and geese, with the deer, raccoons, owls, and orioles who visit the backyard, and the whales or cedar waxwings who stop by on semi-annual migrations? Who constitutes the family? Who are her neighbors? Who are the members of the community? Visitors, friends, foreigners? Our circles of concern might more aptly be represented like this, with animals in each of the circles, parts of all of these circles of concern. In our work on animals and citizenship, Will and I are frequently charged with anthropomorphic projection or anthropocentric straitjacketing by taking allegedly human concepts, such as citizen or political agent, and extending them to animals. Indeed, one hears similar criticism about using any words that identify animals as agents in social relations, whether as workers, teachers, parents, colleagues, allies, rebels, leaders, or more simply, persons. And so, too, concepts describing the virtues and vices of citizens and persons. I'm thinking of virtues, citizenship virtues, like tolerance, self-restraint, cooperation, and courage. The claim is that these words and concepts in their archetypal form, or their conceptual core, are human-based, originating in human relations, learned first through application to human others. Only later do we analogize or extend these concepts to animals, allegedly doing violence in the process to the concepts and to animal difference. But in fact, we learn and shape these concepts in interspecies relationships, and their origins and meaning embody the agency and history of animals, not just our own. Indeed, it's only after intense ideological indoctrination that children learn to exclude animals from the purview of these concepts. So to use such concepts in relation to animals is not to make an anthropomorphic error of projection or to engage in conceptual overstretch or enlargement of our affective sphere, but rather to use words in the very context in which we and animals originally came to understand and shape their meaning. It's the artificial exclusion of animals that does violence, both to the concepts and to the animals themselves. This is the sense in which the Zoopolis model is more accurately seen not as an extensionist approach, but as a restorational or a recognitional approach. It seeks not to extend membership to those separate from or outside of political community, but to recognize membership of those already in our community and to restore to them their rightful status as co-contributors to our shared world. But how exactly should we recognize that humans and animals are already always implicated in interspecies relationships? Our proposal, as noted earlier, is through group-differentiated rights, and in the case of domesticated animals, recognition of membership through co-citizenship in the communities that they share with us. Citizenship is the legal and political tool we use in our societies to recognize membership and to uphold the rights of membership. And here we encounter the second example I wanted to discuss of how human-centric myths distort our understanding both of existing realities, myths about what, on our best theories, citizenship is and how it works. According to many narratives found amongst both defenders and critics of animal rights, citizenship is wedded to the ideal of the ideal or normative citizen, from which we extend outwards to see who measures up and can be included. Traditional conceptions of citizenship going back to the Greeks focus on the centrality of reason and speech, and this conception has continued up to and including modern conceptions of political membership, based on capacities for public reason, rational deliberation, and moral reflection. Following Gary Steiner, I'm going to call this cluster of capacities linguistic agency. This picture has as its center the image of the ideal citizen and the capacities he must possess, i.e. those of a normal adult human. For those individuals who are not or are not perceived to be normal linguistic agents, bringing them into citizenship requires one of two strategies. Either we show that they have been misperceived and indeed are normal adult humans possessing linguistic agency, and that's arguably how women and racial minorities and people with physical disabilities have been brought into citizenship practices. The second strategy is to find indirect grounds on which to bring in people into the sphere of the normal, so-called normal, in terms of potential capacities, former possession of capacities, membership in a group that possesses such capacities, or relationships of attachment to such members. The first strategy says a mistake has been made in the application of the test for citizenship. The second says there are warranted exceptions to the test that allow us to embrace a wider community, at least of humans. many animal rights theorists have pointed out the problem with this kind of extensionist approach in relation to moral status for animals. Gary Francione talks about similar minds theory, for example, in which animals are measured by proximity to perceived normative human capacities. And he's right that this approach is deeply problematic. It's problematic in its sweeping and frequently inaccurate generalizations about the capacities possessed by various members of society, and problematic in the way it posits linguistic agency or other capacities as the human-centered core of moral status. Individuals are viewed not as who they are, but as measured against the norm or ideal. And deviation from this norm, if you are human, is arrogantly conceived as misfortune or impairment or temporary embarrassment, which so-called normals generously overlook since you are kin. If you're a non-human animal, extent of deviation from this norm marks the measure of your lesser status. And we can see that this idea of normative human capacities is a problem for how we conceive human moral status, not just a possible extension to animals. So while many animal rights theorists have argued that we can and must overcome this neurotypical approach to ideas of moral status and personhood, a surprising number say we cannot do the same thing with respect to citizenship. Citizenship theory is said to be necessarily wedded to an idea of linguistic agency as a precondition of citizenship status. Gary Steiner argues that citizenship cannot be severed from this model in which linguistic agency is a defining condition or a normative ideal, one that will always disadvantage animals since they can never be, in his words, fully empowered ethico-juridical political agents. This is why Steiner proposes that we shift from ideas of citizenship or social justice to the idea of cosmic justice in order to include animals. But this is to mistake the true promise of citizenship for its impoverished representation in traditional political theories. The image of the ideal or normative citizen centered in linguistic agency is invoked ideologically to defend the view that citizenship is an exclusively human status. It is a crucial linchpin in human exclusivist conceptions of politics. But just as the neurotypical view is inadequate as an account of moral status, so too it is inadequate as an account of citizenship, and not just for animals. It is an completely inadequate conception of citizenship for all of us. So our goal shouldn't be to abandon social justice for cosmic justice, or rather to extend social justice to cosmic justice. Our goal should be to demonstrate that social justice and citizenship are not tethered to linguistic agency, and that our best conception and practices of citizenship are far more inclusive than this traditional theoretical model suggests. In recent decades, this inclusive conception of citizenship or social justice has been advocated in particular by feminist disability and children's rights theorists. And this conception doesn't center on the ideal citizen who meets a threshold condition in terms of a set of idealized traits like rational speech, rational deliberation, moral agency. Nor does it start with a conception of the ideal citizen fulfilling certain functions like voting or sitting on juries. Rather, citizenship is an ethos of membership, a commitment to include all who are present, all who are affected. And it's a commitment not just to represent the interests of all who are here, but to enable the participation of all in the creation of society in spaces and ways that are meaningful to them, enabling us all to be ethico-juridico-political agents, in Steiner's terms. In children's rights and disability theory, this is sometimes called the 3P model: provision, protection, and participation, the right of everyone, linguistic agent or not, to have a say in the key matters affecting their lives. From this perspective, if we want to assess whether we live in a just society, the question is not, is this the best society that rational actors or linguistic agents can imagine and agree on? The question is, how good a job are we doing of including everyone who is here, especially the most vulnerable? This conception of citizenship does not involve any notion of core and periphery. It is one in which all members of the community are equally at the core of our conception. Young and old, newcomer or long settled, linguistic agent or interdependent agent, and so on. We start by looking at who is here, how do we build a society together in which all of us can flourish. There's no ideal or normative citizen. There's a diversity of actual citizens. Sometimes having a say about the key matters affecting our lives will involve making day-to-day choices about friends or activities and environments rather than sitting on a jury. Sometimes learning and engaging social norms will be more a question of habituation, embodiment, and trial and error rather than reflection and analysis. Sometimes having our interests represented will occur through forms of interdependent agency, body language, and interpretation, rather than articulation of our values and wishes through propositional speech or in the voting booth. There are no marginal cases in this conception of citizenship because there's no norm against which we are measured. This is the model of citizenship that our societies are now committed to, reflected in the UN Declaration on the Rights of the Child and People with Disabilities, which affirms citizenship including full participation rights. The language of having a say in key matters affecting your life, that's from the UN Declaration on the Rights of the Child. And it includes infants up. This is a conception of citizenship to which Will and I would argue domesticated animals are clearly entitled. How precisely to enable domesticated animals to exercise this citizenship is obviously a challenge, one that Will's going to discuss. But to reject citizenship for animals on the grounds that they are too distant from the core of normative citizenship, defined as linguistic agency, is to accept a myth that distorts the ethos of citizenship in order to preserve a human-centric conception of society and politics. So I've considered two examples of how we must avoid the trap of accepting human-centric ideologies about the nature of society and politics. Our societies have always been more than human, and our politics has always been more than linguistic agency. So there's no theoretical impediment to recognizing the citizenship of domesticated animals. Of course, the devil is in the details, and that's my cue to turn the talk over to Will.
So, as Sue said, the focus of our theory is on trying to imagine the post-abolition world. You can think of this as a kind of morning after question. So on day one, the Supreme Court declares that animals are persons, not property. And now the question is, the morning after, what do we do? How do we relate to animals? And our assumption is that we need to work out new relationships that are consistent with respect for the personhood and rights of animals. And that, as Sue has already said, and this slide was shown before, that we imagine, at least as a starting point, three different kinds of relationships that might emerge the morning after. One of which is based on this idea, or is consistent with the idea of kind of separate worlds, and this would be the case of sovereign wild animal communities, that where wild animals live on their own habitat, live autonomously and independently of us, they in a sense live in a separate world, and we should respect that by according them sovereignty and protect their sovereign territory from colonization and invasion by humans. But that's not going to be the case for most animals on the planet. We think we need to work out other kinds of relationships for them. And so in the case of domesticated animals, our argument is that we've brought them into our society and we need to recognize their membership rights and that will take the form of recognizing them as co-citizens. And that with respect to the non-domesticated animals who live not out there on their own sovereign territory, but who live here amongst us, the urban wildlife, if you like, that we need to recognize that although they have not been brought into our social world the way that domesticated animals have, they share the same space with us. And so they need to be recognized as having residency rights, the rights to live amongst us, and the rights to be accommodated in the pursuit of their ways of life, and that we call that idea of denizenship. Okay, so for the rest of the talk, I want to focus in particular on the idea of co-citizenship for domesticated animals, because I think in a way that's the sharpest contrast with some other animal rights theories. And so what I want to do is just very quickly restate the moral argument for why we owe citizenship to domesticated animals, and then to consider some of the details of what it would mean in terms of the rights and responsibilities of citizenship, and then to address what some obvious objections to the story. So what's the moral argument for citizenship is really actually very simple. We have brought domesticated animals into our society, we've taken them out of the wild, and bred them to become dependent on us, in such a way that at least in the immediate future they do not have the option of exiting and rewilding. So we have brought them into our society, rendered them dependent on us. We have thereby made them members of our society, and we owe them membership rights. So the question of justice for domesticated animals is not just what we owe them as sentient individual beings, what we owe them in virtue of the fact that we've taken them out of the wild, bred them to be dependent on us, and incorporated them into our society and into our schemes of economy and society and so on. And our argument is we clearly have a duty to recognize them as members. We've made them members. We need to recognize that fact. and citizenship is a legal tool for recognizing membership. But it's also important that domestication makes citizenship possible in the following sense. To think of someone as a co-citizen is, I mean, citizenship is a cooperative relationship. And so to think of someone as a co-citizen is to imagine being able to engage in cooperative relations with them, which in turn requires trust, it requires the ability to communicate, it requires the ability to comply with certain shared norms, and the ability to live in physical proximity with others. These are attributes that are not possible. These are kinds of relationships that we can't have with all animals on the planet. We can't have these kinds of relationships with spitting cobras or with eel-pug fish living deep in the Pacific Ocean. But we know that we can have these kinds of relationships with domesticated animals because domestication only works with animals who are capable of this kind of interspecies sociability. That is a precondition of domestication, and domestication has typically worked over time to strengthen the capacity of domesticated animals to have this kind of trust, physical proximity, communication, shared norms, and so on. Okay, so in our view, domestication makes the extension of citizenship both morally necessary and possible. So what would that mean in practice? Well, in the human case, we typically think of citizenship as a bundle of rights and responsibilities, and so too we can think about rights and responsibilities for domesticated animals. So in the book we have a kind of long list of both rights and responsibilities, but just to pick up some highlights, extending citizenship to domesticated animals would extend them the rights to equal protection, not just in the sense of being protected from deliberate harm at the hands of humans, killing, hunting, trapping, so on, because those, on our view, those apply to all animals, domesticated or not, but also protection against other kinds of potential harms or risks. So we have a duty to protect domesticated animals from predators. Having brought them into our society, we owe them that kind of protection, but also protection against other kinds of natural risks and harms, like fire and flood. And so emergency services should be trained and equipped to rescue domesticated animals in cases of fire and flood. So there's a picture of rescue of a horse in a flood. It would also include social rights. So we're Canadians, so we think that one of the rights of citizenship is public health care, public insurance. And so we think that domesticated animals should have public health insurance. And insofar as they work, and I will come back to that in a sec, insofar as domesticated animals are engaged in work, then they should have workers' rights, which should include the right to work in safe conditions, the right to maximum working hours, the right to retirement, and so on. But it also includes political rights. That's to say that domestic animals should be viewed as members of the people in whose name the state governs. Their interests should be included in determining what is in the public good of the people. And that there therefore must be mechanisms in place to solicit and be responsive to the subjective good of animals in determining the shared rules that govern our society. So those are some of the rights of citizenship. It's one of the distinctive features of our story, and perhaps controversially, that we could also think about the responsibilities of domesticated animals in virtue of their citizenship. And so let me just quickly discuss two. Since the whole theory is based on the idea that we share a social world together with domesticated animals, this means that we are all expected to comply with social norms. There are some norms of living together. We need to learn to live sociably, peacefully, civilly with each other as members of a shared social world, so we need to learn to comply with certain social norms. And so you can think of this, that we socialize dogs not to bite, not to jump up on people. That's an example in which in the name of coexistence, we socialize domesticated animals to comply with social norms. It's also a feature of imagining domesticated animals as part of a shared social world, and their interests contribute to the public good, but we also expect all members of society to contribute to the common good. That's part of what it, again, means to think of us as engaged in cooperation and sharing a society together. And so here we've got a picture of dogs as rescue animals. As one way of potentially contributing to society. Now these responsibilities are obviously deeply controversial, and particularly amongst many animal rights advocates, who worry that the way in which our theory might justify socializing animals to comply with social norms and expect them to contribute is going to lead to domination and exploitation. So on the issue of socialization, so many people worry that if we say that in the name of shared social membership and shared citizenship, that we're permitted to socialize domesticated animals to comply with social norms, that this is going to involve coercion and domination. And it's of course true that today, the ways in which we socialize domesticated animals to comply with social norms is indeed deeply oppressive and dominating because there's such asymmetry in the way in which this socialization works. That's to say, whenever domesticated animals impose even the slightest burden or inconvenience on us, we immediately exert all sorts of power and control in order to make sure they don't in any way burden or inconvenience us, while we're completely oblivious to the ways in which we are all the time imposing huge burdens and inconveniences on domesticated animals. So that's obviously a crucial problem. But the solution to that is not to say that any form of socialization is inherently wrong or dominating or coercive, because the reality is any form of society requires that its members be socialized. We do it to human children. Wild animals who are social species do it to their young. Wolves socialize their young. Humans socialize their young. What matters is whether the norms to which all members of society are being socialized are ones that allow everyone to flourish. And that's a crucial part of the citizenship theory, is to make sure that the social norms that we're being socialized to comply with are ones that enable everyone to flourish, that are responsible to the subjective good of all. And that means that socialization must be mutual. And so just as we would socialize dogs not to jump up and bite children, so children need to learn not to poke dogs in the eye. So. Okay, now contribution. So at the moment, we coercively extract labor and products from animals in ways that are brutal and violent and coercive. But again, our view is that we shouldn't view the very idea of contribution as inherently dominating or exploitative. But on the contrary, it's part of a healthy society that its members want to contribute. That's what we might think is actually a sign that we live in a genuinely mutual society. Is that people, young, both young humans and also young domesticated animals, would be looking for ways to contribute. And I think there are many ways in which domesticated animals can contribute that are non-exploitative, non-harmful. And so here's just some pictures, again, of a rescued dog. This is a picture, the one on the right is a picture of the goats that they use at San Francisco Airport to keep the grass down. And the reason they use goats rather than lawnmowers is because there's some protected plant species nearby that would be harmed by the lawnmowers, but the goats leave, and llamas protecting sheep. So those seem to me relatively benign forms of contribution that are consistent with the interests and inclinations of animals, and that's what we're looking for. We're looking for ways in which all members of society, human and domesticated animal, can contribute in ways that are consistent with their interests and inclinations. Of course, at some point, these forms of contribution become exploitative. And so in our book, I mean, we can all easily imagine hundreds of examples, but at some point, the mutually respectful contribution tips over into exploitation. And so one example we give is the use of guide dogs for the blind. On our view, that is really enslavement. They are expected to work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 350 days a year. They're not allowed to socialize with other dogs. That's enslavement. But that's not true about all forms of labor that domesticated animals contribute, which they seem to, in many cases, find satisfaction in, and so on. And the society would find ways for all members to. Okay, sorry. So that's a quick sketch of our citizenship theory for domesticated animals. And as I say, in one sense, it's got this very simple logic. We've brought them into our society through domestication. We therefore owe them membership. Membership takes the form of citizenship, and that comes with a bundle of rights and responsibilities. That's the very simple idea. And I hope some of you at least will find at least something intuitively attractive about it. But there are some obvious worries. And so I just want to conclude by considering some of the obvious objections. So one worry is that while this may sound progressive to extend citizenship to domesticated animals, it will in practice just turn out to be another way in which we dominate animals and govern them to fit our society. So it just becomes yet another tool of domination, in particular because, unlike other citizens, domesticated animals are not able to take up arms against us if they're feeling exploited. They're not able of organizing general strikes to contest their terms of employment or whatever. They're not able to vote. So ultimately, and of course they are, we have bred them to be dependent on us. So these are vulnerable, dependent members of society who are not able to exercise collective power against us. So ultimately this citizenship story depends very much on the good faith of humans to actually make it work. And yet we know humans have a very strong self-interest in their exploitation. And so isn't the likely outcome going to be that we'll call them citizens, you know, let's imagine miraculously someone accepts the theory, we call them citizens, but it doesn't actually end up helping them. What we'll do, we'll call them citizens, but it'll just be empty rhetoric, and in the name of citizenship, we'll continue to socialize them, not to burden us, and we'll continue to extract contributions from them, but when it comes to their rights, then we're just not going to kind of ignore those, and we'll end up, under the name of citizenship, just reproducing forms of domination and exploitation. Okay, so that's a very serious worry. And so if this story is to have any meaning, we need to think about what would be the ways in which we actually test whether our shared social life, whether our shared social norms and practices are or are not responsive to the subjective good of all members, including domesticated animals. That's the test that citizenship sets. How do we apply that test? So we need some way to figure out what kinds of social norms, what kinds of social life together domesticated animals themselves want to have. Citizenship theory needs to ask that question and answer it, if it's to be effective. Okay, and that raises an interesting puzzle, which is that very, very few people have asked the question, what kind of social life do domesticated animals want to have with us? This is remarkable how rarely that question has been asked, either by people inside the animal rights movement or by people outside it. We do have this field for 30 years of animal welfare science, which seems sometimes to be asking a related question about what animals find pleasurable or satisfying, what animals, domesticated animals find stressful, and so on. And so we have this 30 years of literature on animal welfare, but it's more or less useless from our point of view, or in any event, it's not particularly helpful from a citizenship point of view, because all of that literature, the animal welfare science, which is all industry funded, it all takes as a given the purposes of the relationship. It assumes that the purpose of our relating with a domesticated animal is already set by us. And then, so what's the purpose of our relationship with pigs? To produce pork. So that's set. And then animal welfare science comes along and says, how can we make sure that we minimize the stress of pigs in that relationship? You know, is pens or stalls better, groups of six, groups of 12, you know, measure their cortisol levels to see what they find more stressful. Okay, that's not the kind of question we're interested in. A citizenship model starts from the premise that we need to ask what kinds of cooperative activities, if any, domesticated animals want to engage in with us. A citizenship model says that the shared rules that govern our life together must be responsive to their wishes as much as ours. So we need to find out what kind of relationships and activities domesticated animals want to engage in with us, or with other members of other species, or as members of their own species. And we haven't asked that question as much as we ought, in part because, all too often, we assume that there's only one kind of life that is possible for domesticated animals. Many people assume that because of their DNA, or because of breeding, because of domestication, that the nature of their life was fixed once and for all, and that they're only possible of having one kind of relationship with us, they're only possible of having one kind of life. But the reality is, domesticated animals are capable of having many different possible lives, engaging in many different kinds of relationships with us, with conspecifics, or with members of other animal species. I mean, anyone who spent any time at a at a farm sanctuary will know what are the incredible universe of possible relationships that exist amongst conspecifics and across species lines. And so the task is to set up opportunity, and what we need to find out is which of those kinds of activities domesticated animals want to engage in with us or with their conspecifics or with other domesticated animals. And so we need to set up conditions under which domesticated animals are able to explore these different options and to express their preferences for them, including the preferences of having nothing to do with us. Of course, because they've been bred to be dependent on us, that the option of immediate full exit is not realistic for most domesticated animals. But we can set up opportunities for domesticated animals to partially exit from us, to become semi-feral in graduated safe steps. And if we provided those options, my guess is that some domesticated animals would indeed quite quickly and consistently vote with their feet to have as little as possible to do with us. I think this would be true about horses, for example. It seems to me that in order to get horses to cooperate with us, we have to break them. This is clearly not something, and so I think they would quite quickly choose a feral existence. And we would return to a situation in which we have feral wild horses. But other domesticated animals might, given the choice, might well choose to continue to associate with humans, and possibly even to want to spend more time with us. I mean, if you think about some dogs, one of the terrible things we do with them is leave them alone for 6 hours. They want to spend, it's quite possible that they would want to spend more time with us if we offered them interesting cooperative activities. But of course, dogs love to socialize with each other as well, and so given the choice, they would certainly want to spend more time with conspecifics, but also with us. In any event, this is something we need to leave as an open question, to what extent domesticated animals would choose, given these options, what kinds of activities they want to spend with us. Okay. And so the idea is that if we create these kinds of conditions under which domesticated animals can express safely explore different options for different kinds of lives, and we're responsive to their expressed preferences, then the citizenship model would be emancipatory. It wouldn't just become another vehicle by which we dominate them. It would indeed be generally emancipatory. Of course, there are risks. Because they're vulnerable and dependent, there's going to be, inevitably, risks of, and because we have a self-interest in exploiting them, this model is always going to be subject to the risks of coercion, manipulation, and adaptive preferences. And those risks ramp up immeasurably as soon as if we allow for the commercialization of animal labor or animal products. And this would be the strong self-interest in bad faith interpretations of animals' preferences and interests. So those are clearly important worries that we need to keep in mind. But I'll just say two things about those. One is that we need to remember that there are vulnerable, independent humans. It's not just animals who are domesticated animals who are vulnerable and dependent. We have vulnerable, independent humans in our society who have exactly the same risks in terms of their status in our society. And we are continually, as a society, confronted with the challenge of how do we address these risks in relation to vulnerable, independent humans. And we've learned some things. Sue talked about this, about how the disability literature and the children's rights literature, which is addressing exactly these kinds of risks. And our argument is that we can learn from that to think about how to protect against these risks in relation to domesticated animals. But the other thing I'd say is that there are risks on the other side. That if we say in advance that it's the best thing we can do for domesticated animals is to render them extinct, or to forcibly expel them from our society in order to rewild them, we are, you know, that's its own form of unilateral domination. We are denying them the possibility that their expressed preference would be to continue to associate with us in some ways, for some purposes, in some contexts. Okay, so the basic conclusion is, we need to try to find ways of figuring out what kinds of lives domesticated animals want to share with us, under what conditions, and so on. And we shouldn't be prejudging that. But again, the moral premise is that they have a birthright in society. in membership. We have brought them into our society. They have thereby acquired a birthright in our society, and we need to give them the opportunity to explore how they can benefit from it. And again, while it's true that some domesticated animals are almost certainly going to choose to partially or fully exit in these safe and gradual steps, we should also expect that some domesticated animals will choose to maintain various kinds of relationships with us, because there are benefits of interspecies life. There are ways of experiencing the world that are possible in interspecies contexts that are not possible if one's world is solely a conspecifics. And so these are just some examples of ways in which domesticated animals genuinely seem to benefit, to flourish from the fact that they share a social world, and not just with us, but with other domesticated animals. So the bottom picture about the pig, I mean, you know, the pigs are incredible. They are so sociable that they genuinely seek out social relationships across species lines. And it seems to me we need to take seriously that capacity to experience and to benefit from interspecies social life is actually in its own way a remarkable capacity, which we of course have horribly abused. The fact that the domesticated animals had this capacity for interspecies sociability, we took advantage of and then subjected them to unbelievable cruelty and exploitation. But we should think about what ways in which we and they can benefit from interspecies life. Okay, so just to conclude, this is the promise of the citizenship model. I hope Sue and I have been able to give you some flavor of why we think there is some genuine promise here. And of course it has risks, and we need to take seriously what those risks are and what the safeguards would be. But I just want to conclude by saying we have a moral duty to, our argument is we have a moral duty to try to create just co-citizenship relations with our domesticated animals. We have no right to expel them. They are here. We've brought them into our society. We need to recognize their membership, and we need to recognize, as I say, that they have a birthright in our society and the right to the fruits of the society that they have helped to build. Okay, that's mainly a philosophical argument, but I just want to conclude by drawing out one possible implication for strategy. So, if as I think too much animal rights theory currently does, we ignore or render invisible these facts of interspecies sociability, and we instead think about animals as the last ultimate distant stranger in circles of concern, if we think about animals as this kind of ultimately distant other, and our concern for those animals comes only after we've extended our ethical concern from the self, the family, the tribe, the nation, and humanity, then I think we're in danger of losing what are some very important levers for change and for ethical transformation. The fact is that, Gary Steiner himself says that on his view, because concern for animals comes at the very end, after all these other expanding circles of concern, that it's this kind of Herculean task of extending beyond human social, beyond our social world to a cosmic sphere of ethical concern. But our view is that animals are there from the start. They're right there with us in the family and in the neighborhood. And that our concern for animals, just as our concern for humans, starts from those that are closest to us. And so we learn to care for animals as we learn to care for humans, through attachment, through identification, through trust, cooperation with those who are closest to us, and then gradually extend outwards. And that therefore, it's a crucial step politically to get people to think of themselves as belonging to more than human families, as that first circle of concern. We belong to more than human families, and once people start to think of themselves as belonging to more than human families, they'll start to think of themselves as belonging to more than human neighborhoods, more than human workplaces, and then in turn to a more than human political community. And that mechanism, we have some idea of how that mechanism can work and how we could try to take advantage of that expanding circles of concern if we recognize that animals are there from the start as part of an interspecies society, and we cut off all those options for political transformation if we instead think about animals as the ultimately distant stranger at the outer circles of concern. Okay, so our idea is that we start from the fact of the interspecies society, the bonds of membership, and that animals, domesticated animals, have rights of membership and the rights to the fruits of our interspecies society. And just last sentence, though, we should not deny this right, this right of membership and the right to share in the fruits of interspecies society, on the myth that society is essentially or purely a human construct, or the myth that society is solely an achievement of our world and not also their world. Thank you.
If you want to take one or two, we'll have to be brief, but take one or two questions if you wish.
So it's a very interesting challenge to think about how individual animals move between these species, and so between these categories, and so and they could move in both directions. So you could imagine what we're calling liminal animals, which could include feral animals, could include things like raccoons. You could imagine that raccoons, for example, so raccoons are huge in Toronto. I don't know how much of an issue it is here, but there's just a lot of them in people's backyards, and they're not domesticated, and so they're not inherently trusting of humans. They tend to keep a wary distance. But you know, if you leave food out, you can develop relationships of trust with an individual raccoon. And you could imagine over time that it would not just come up to the backyard or back door, but it would start to come into the house, and gradually over time it would become to look more and more like a companion animal. And then, to my mind, there's a very interesting ethical question about should society make it possible for more and more liminal animals to express a preference to become domesticated co-citizens? Is that a route that we as a society should try to make available for the urban wildlife, that if they want, they can come over time to develop more trusting relationships that would bring them into a shared social world and not just a shared physical space? Or on the contrary, are there huge risks involved in creating that kind of a path from liminal denizenship to domesticated co-citizenship? And is this something that we don't want to just leave up to individual discretion, because it has implications for all of us? That once a raccoon becomes co-citizenship, we all start acquire certain kinds of obligations, not just the person who established that initial relationship of trust. But of course, it can also go on the other way, that on our story, domesticated animals who are clearly part of the shared social world now would be offered the opportunity of exit. So a partial graduated exit, such that they would become more like liminal animals, or ultimately even wilderness animals if they retreat far enough away. So it's part of our story that we need to enable animals to explore possibilities about what kinds of lives they want to lead. And that means that these categories are not determined by DNA, they're not determined by species membership, they're determined by evolving relationships. But it's not a free-for-all, because there are ethical dilemmas involved in each of these kinds of movements, in which we are changing the risks that animals face, and we're changing the obligations that other humans face. And so this would need to be a matter of kind of not just left to individual discretion, but we would need to have kind of conscious social policies about what are appropriate, fair, ethical conditions and processes by which individual animals move between them.
I'm wondering how bugs and insects fit into this realm, you know, cockroaches, termites,
yeah.
Ants.
Our theory is a theory about sentient animals, and there's obviously great controversy these days about whether insects and bugs are sentient, and honestly, I don't know the scientific answer to that question. So primarily, we are concerned with those cases where we do know the answer to that question. If it turns out that insects are sentient, that's obviously going to be a huge problem in the sense of how could we find circumstances of justice to live in with insects. And our theory in general is circumscribed by an idea of there being circumstances of justice. We cannot achieve justice in those circumstances where you know we're basically required to sacrifice our own capacity to live in order to coexist with someone. Having said that, there are probably lots of things that we could do to reduce our violence towards insects, and we should certainly do those things, and we should always be trying to find ways to increase the opportunities for the circumstances of justice to cohere. But that would be the situation we're in if it's true that they are sentient.
And it seems to me like opening up the sentience question could just be a very slippery slope. Into, you know, if we rule out one species or one variety of species, then that could potentially lead to, you know, gradation of all the other types of sentient beings, you know, putting primates above dogs and that kind of thing.
Yes, I mean, one of the really difficult things about the science here, I think, is that we have so little understanding of what consciousness is and what conscious experience is. And there's no reason evolutionarily to think that it only emerged in one way and, you know, with one... and so there's just so much that we don't know about that. And I think a lot of these questions about what we would do as we figure out more will depend on what we learn about those kinds of questions. I guess...
Yeah, I think you're going to... I want to keep this going on time. And there'll be plenty of... Thank you both very much. That was just a remarkable amount of information transmitted in a limited amount of time. It was just awesome, actually. We're going to take a break. I want us to be back in our chairs, please, by 12:20. And I hope you're enjoying it. And again, you know, if you see the speakers out there, let them have a chance to decompress. And we'll see you back at 12:20. Thank you.